Good afternoon, everyone. Hi. Thank you all so much for coming. I'm Richard Carrick, Chair of Composition here at Berklee. We're thrilled to continue today with our visiting artist, George Lewis, who is here for this afternoon. We've asked him, and he's kindly agreed to give a talk about some of his recent music and works and musical engagements. So please join me in welcoming Professor Lewis.
Hey, thanks everyone for coming. It's very good to be here. This is partly formal talk a little bit, although I go off the grid at certain points, but there's certain things I just wanted to get quite exactly. This is a talk about voice, and it's actually, some of the work is kind of recent and some of it isn't. I'm starting out with a not so recent work, and I'm sort of moving forward to more recent things over the course of like in the next hour or so. But it's all about voice, the uses of voice, about text, about working with text and incorporating that with music. So it's sort of unified that way. It's not just pieces I thought I would play for you, but they're all kind of connected this way. And part of the reason why I was thinking about voices is occasioned by the first piece I'm going to play for you, but which it turns out to have something to do with an article. You know, I also do a lot of academic and quasi-academic writing. And so a few years ago, I wrote an article, a foreword to a book of poetry by improvisers called Silent Solos, Improvisers Speak. And the idea was, the title of it is, When Improvisers Speak, Where Do Their Words Go? Maybe some of you know the African-American literary theorist Fred Moten. And he wrote an extraordinary book called In the Break, The Aesthetics of the Black Radical Tradition. And he quotes Charles Lloyd, saxophonist, who Charles was asked, they said, well, can you tell me about your music? And he says, Charles says, words don't go there. So as a response, Fred Moten says, well, where do words go? And so my suggestion is wherever words go, they travel at the speed of thought, and they actually move faster than music. Now, think about this. I can hear a lot of musicians responding. Well, you hear sounds right away, right? Well, not right away. I think the idea is that event-related potentials in the brain, you know, perceiving, it's actually pretty slow. It could be almost I think it's pretty slow. I don't remember how slow it is. Half second after you hear it. You know, which you don't, that's not quite as immediate as people thought. But in any event, music, this interactive, dialogic structuring of sound by musicians and listeners, you know, it's another matter entirely. The phenomenologists and music theorists tell us music unfolds in both recollective time and expectational time. And that process can take quite a while. And it's extending deep into memory and, you know, involving a lot of work. Now, poetry is said to be the form of textual expression that most closely approaches the condition of music, but even that identification is undercut by the infinite play of meaning that unfolds and expands word by word even before the poet has finished the first thought, but well before the musician has finished the first phrase. Now, think of it. It really super energetic musical performance, quicksilver notes, rhythms, harmonies, noise. It's really just poking along while the hearers reconstruct the context, consider the meanings, experience its effect. During that time, someone can say cheeseburger. And that's just one thing. And that fragment had already generated a network of meaning in an instant. So I've often found it quite ironic how the Watts Writers' Workshop, for example, they were so influenced by the immediacy of music. When you think about a haiku, it seems to win that race every time. But I think the uneasy, trickster-like intersection between these two temporal universes, poetry with music, that's a source of hidden pleasure. It's a kind of a dilemma in some ways, a sensuous dilemma that, let's say, improvisers and improvising poets have to address. How to reconcile two experiences of time, remembrance, recollection, and fantasy, where indeterminacy and agency meet. That's in one. And on the other, operating in the interstices between immediacy and fantasy. So that gets me to the first piece I wanted to try out for you all. It's from 1996. It's called North Star Boogaloo. It's for percussion and audio. It used to be called tape. Now they just call it fixed media, whatever they call it. And that was written for my former UCSD colleague and still friend, Stephen Schick, while we were colleagues at UC San Diego. And the text is by Quincy Troop, who was also a UCSD colleague at the time. Quincy Troop, if you recall, was the person who basically wrote the Miles Davis autobiography and gave Miles Davis a voice in some ways, or found a way to transduce or translate Miles's voice into the written word. So in 1995 or so, Steve asked me about making a piece for him, and we quickly ruled out having improvisation as a part of the piece for reasons I'll explain to you later. And that I was doing a lot of work with computer interactivity. I still do, you know, computers that improvise and listen to musicians and play stuff with them. So I was wondering how to extend that practice, which was an improvisative practice where the computers and the people were improvising together, how to extend that into a piece that was not going to be improvised. So Steve has published a very thoughtful essay in his 2006 book, The Publisher's Art, Percussionist Art, excuse me, about this piece, and I'll just read you a bit of it. From the outset, George wanted to combine a small percussion setup, thus establishing a limited range of percussion sounds we played live, with a technological system activated in real time that would radically multiply the number of available sounds, including many non-percussion sources. The idea was that sound files would be available for playback via pedal-activated triggers in our more elaborate discussions through more interactive means like a computer with score following capabilities. For a variety of reasons, George opted for a straightforward arrangement of live performer and pre-recorded tape. Okay, so that at that point, Quincy Troop, who came in and upended the discussion. Now, I've been doing poetry slam type improvisations with Quincy for a while, but I was getting kind of uneasy with that model of performance intertextuality, and I was having trouble trying to figure out what actually to play in spontaneous yet structured connection with the words. You know, I have a similar thing about improvising with paintings. I don't never quite know what to do. And I also felt that the process wasn't really allowing me to reap the benefits of the kind of close reading of poetry that I was used to, that I, you know, did in school, and I actually read a lot. And so I suggested to Quincy, I said, well, look, instead of doing this in a poetry slam, why don't you let me write you something? He said, okay, you can write something. So I settled on a poem of his called Following the North Star Boogaloo, which was dedicated to fellow poet Miguel Algarin. Now, North Star Boogaloo, I will read a bit of it for you so you can see what it's like, okay? I'm not a good poetry reader like performer, but I'm going to give it a go. Okay, following the North Star Boogaloo, the rhythm takes me back to where music began, to percolate language like coffee in another form, back before Frederick Douglass laid it down heavy on Abe Lincoln, when music was breakdancing, old Hottentots throwing down mean as Bojangles ever did. Now jump forward through history's dice game, pick up the steps of James Brown, Michael Jackson moonwalking, the old blues talking about your mama. Now fast forward down the lane, pick up the dance of five brothers, skateboarding the court. Out in the open, one closes the break after taking it to the hole off the coast to coast, doing 180-degree five slammer jammer dunk, before they all high-five and glad hand, after stamping their footprints all up in this paint, up in this poet's word dribble, a drummer's paradiddle, word up, yo bro, hip-hop, rappers, skateboarding the go-go out in the open court of macking the Holy Ghost down. So that's a sense of what the poem is about. I'll give you a little bit more because you need to see, there's a lot of social context to this. It's not just nostalgia. Hey you diddle-diddle, voodoo griot, take me back to when I was black and hit and proud, out on the slick bop thoroughfares, back before the mean homeboys rolled snarling, duck waddled down the middle, eyes empty with death, before the alley-oops wore their lives as chips on shoulders, in stratospheric attitudes, hung dip from wall to wall, chain gold, cap bills on heads quacking sideways, muscling up bold master blasters, checking out Reeboks, chill up, chilling dead up in the cut, fresh as death, after mo' money, mo' money, mo' money. Check it out, bro. Pharmaceutical wizards making seven-figure bank accounts do somersaults. No sweat. It's rolling in so fast for crack, it ain't nothing but a hole in the wall. For homeboys, cash and carry, cold 16-year-olds who can't count nothing but greenbacks. So that's a part of it. Now, the this is not a conventional composer setting of that poem. In fact, I didn't even use the entire poem. I selected portions of it in a way that allowed me to tell a story in words and sounds. And I'll tell you more about this. Now, let's see if I can find a bit of this. There are two rappers and that's how it's written. That's how it's written out. There are two rappers in North Star Boogaloo. The percussionist, whose part is completely notated, and Virtual Quincy, a computer program that I wrote that contained a lot of pointers. This is when I was thinking I'd make it interactive. So it's a lot of unimplemented interactive subroutines. But it ended up mainly delivering sampled segments of Quincy's voice reading the poem, along with hip-hop beats and other sounds, key points in the score, but never in quite the same, you know. And while what you hear in performance, what I'll play for you, a lot of people play this now, is the best of the several takes the computer did. So in a way, it's like a rebus, which letters and images combine to create a sentence or even a larger narrative. Words and sounds share the narrative throughout the piece. Now, here's an example I just found this morning of it's like an audio rebus. Now, do I have the audio rebus here? There it is.
For the next one, you need to find an activity for the brave. The sounds are... with and
wait a bit.
Okay, take your time.
Alexa, is it flying kite?
That's not the answer I'm expecting. Any more ideas?
Bewitching?
Wrong answer. Any more ideas?
Bespongling?
This is still not the correct answer. If you want, you can ask me for some help with the rebus, or even to skip it. Otherwise, just keep guessing.
Help me with the rebus.
Do you need help with sound number one, two, or three?
The third one.
Okay, audio clue number three is ping. You should be able to guess now.
Beekeeping.
Impressive.
So the poem, of course, deals with basketball as a prime medium for the worldwide dissemination of African-American culture, a site for history and memory, and the poem establishes a relationship with and a critique of popular culture and commodification, which is part of what I wanted to do in this piece. As Stephen Schick puts it, the use of tape in North Star Boogaloo ensures that the performer will follow the electronics. But here, the question of who follows whom is not just a practical detail of performance electronics, but a critical component of the expressive access of the piece as well. Okay, unlike the North Star has played a central role in celestial navigation in this hemisphere, literally for ages. And more to the point of George's piece, the North Star was the singular guiding light that led slaves to freedom as they escaped the plantations of the South, headed north. Basketball as a modern-day North Star beckons to many, especially to young African-Americans who have seen it as a beacon to the kind of freedom that comes with fame and affluence, and so on. So it goes on from there. And so I think that's enough. I want to say something after the piece is over. It's about a 15-minute piece, so... I think we should, I thought we would do parts of pieces, but I think it's better if we hear the whole thing. And then from there, there's a discussion. I wanted to tell you a little bit about what Steve said after the piece, which will give you a sense of why this piece highlights some cultural issues that continue to dog both popular music and experimental music to this day. So this is about 15 minutes or so. This is just the first page of the score, so you can see what it's like. Turn it up a little bit.
hear you.
Rhythm takes me. Take me back to when I was black and hidden proud. Talking about your mama.
The rhythm, the rhythm, the rhythm, the rhythm, the rhythm.
Take me
rhythm,
back to when
rhythm,
I was black.
Rhythm,
take me
the rhythm,
back to when I was
rhythm,
black.
The rhythm,
take
the
me
rhythm,
back to
the
when
rhythm,
I was
the
black.
Rhythm, the
take
rhythm,
me back
the
to
rhythm,
when I was
the
black.
Rhythm,
take
the rhythm,
back
takes
to when
me.
I was black. Jump forward through history's dice game. Pick up the steps, pick up the dance of five
talking
brothers.
About your mama.
Pick up the steps, pick up the dance of five brothers. The rhythm takes me. Jump forward through history's dice game. Poet's word dribble, a drummer's paradiddle. 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 Take me back to when I was black and hidden proud. Take me back, take me back, take me back, take me back, take it, take me, take it, take me back to when I was black. 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 Five brothers skateboarding the court. Take it to the hole. Pick up the steps. Voodoo Briad. Voodoo Briad. Voodoo Briad. Yeah! Going down mean as Bojangles ever did.
I think I'm an artist, especially when I create.
Empty with death. Chilling dead up in the cut. Fresh as death. Is death. Old 16-year-olds who can't count nothing but greenbacks. Chilling dead up in the cut. Fresh as death. Can't count nothing but greenbacks. Can't count nothing but green eyes. Hey, young bro.
Oh, God.
More money. Pick up the steps. Pick up the steps. Pick up the dance of fire. Fresh as death. More money. Pick up the step. Fresh as death. The rhythm takes me. So fresh, they make poop butts faint.
He is amazing.
I didn't know nothing about it.
I don't want to be like Mike.
Say what you say, say what?
I don't want to be like Mike.
Before Magic's knees go permanently south for the winter.
I don't want to be like Mike.
Changing up the guard quicker than fear brings down doo-doo.
With the finger roll, plus the foul.
Hey, young bro.
He never saw Elgin Baylor play during his day or Oscar Robinson.
Flash the dice roll back. The big O was jackknifing through all them bodies.
I didn't know nothing about it.
Flash the dice roll back. Roy Haynes, jitterbug like a magician. The big O Haynes, Roy Haynes, jitterbug like a magician. Beneath the sun. And do they even know about Jonestown? All them bodies. Did we ever think fresh as death?
They still do it now. I didn't know nothing about it.
Oh God.
And did they ever hear about the North Carolina astronaut, David Skywalking Thompson?
He is amazing.
Helicoptering to round ball heaven. Taking it to the hole off the coast to coast. Walking on space, up over your face. Took him right on out like a blown light bulb.
Goodbye.
Did we ever think way back before Kenny Adamson was even a glint in his parents' pick and roll eyes? Off the slide by. Eased on by like Mojo with his yo-yo.
He's become the moment over the top.
Again! He's done it again!
Glory, jackknifing through all them bodies. Say, what? Did you see that?
He is amazing. Amazing.
Somewhere back before language followed the North Star Boogaloo, Cambone and the Black Bottom for fun, homeboys pick cotton, play the dozen. Take me back to when I was black. Take me back.
Say what you say. Say what.
Take me back to when I was black.
Say what you say.
Take me back to when I was black. Take me back to when I was black. Homeboys pick cotton, play the dozen.
Timeout is called.
Hey, young bro. I hate to talk about your mama. I hate to talk about your mama talking. I hate to talk about your mama talking. I hate to talk about your mama. I hate to talk about your mama.
Slide.
I hate to talk about your mama. I hate to talk about your mama. I hate to talk about your mama. She was a good old soul, but she got a 2-ton. And your daddy got a. Say what you say. When we knew ourselves through songs then, through what we saw alive in homeboy's eyes. Hey, young bro. When we knew ourselves through songs then, through what we saw alive in homeboy's eyes.
My grandfather was always scheming on how to get money.
Ourselves through songs then, through what we saw alive in homeboy's eyes, ham boning the black bottom for fun. When we knew ourselves through songs then, through what we saw alive in homeboy's eyes, the rhythm takes me back to where music began. Poets word dribble, a drummer's paradiddle. Glory, up north, south of the voodoo connection, north. Where we enter from Africa.
Thanks. So, thank you very much. Let me say something that might sort of recontextualize what we just heard in some interesting ways. As I said, that Steve Schick's text about the piece highlights some cultural issues that I think are problematic for both popular music and contemporary music. Here's what he says. He says, on one hand, I was very comfortable with the tasks of the piece. I mean, stuff like this, you know, it's not that easy to really play. And he was prepared, I was well prepared to tackle the work's more difficult polyrhythmic passages. On the other hand, I felt uncomfortable playing along with the hip-hop rhythms on the tape, which is at least in the cultural context of 1996, had been also the exclusive province of African-American musicians. What was I doing up there playing this music? In one sense, I took comfort and confidence from the fact that George Lewis had written the piece for me, and if he thought it was inappropriate for me to play, he would certainly not have given it to me. In the first few performances, I didn't try to do anything I wasn't expert at, but what constitutes expertise in a piece about searching? You can be expert only if you have something already found what you're looking for or know how to find it. So the aspects of North Star Boogaloo that were about searching, aspects of the piece in which I could never be expert, slowly began to beckon. In an early performance of the piece at Lincoln Center as a part of the Bang on a Can marathon, I had a sudden flash of the image I was presenting, a white, middle-aged, classically trained percussionist intently focused on accurately rendering hip-hop rhythms to a mostly white, mostly middle-aged audience. I was Ward Cleaver, you know, Leave It to Beaver, in a pickup game of basketball on a Harlem playground. That sudden feeling of not belonging, of never being able to belong, made me feel momentarily ridiculous and later profoundly sad. You see, after my performance was over, I went back to being an expert percussionist playing music I was expert at. I knew where I was, where I was going, and exactly how I was going to get there. I'd only momentarily dipped my toe into the waters of not belonging, of never belonging. I didn't actually have to live there. But in my moment of cultural vertigo, which came from feeling like an outsider, I felt the fear of being lost and glimpsed the pull of the North Star, and so on. So he made me realize that exploration and comfort would never be conveniently mated. So now Steve has played this work a number of times since then. He played it in 2011. Once again, but a lot of people play this. You can find versions on YouTube. People I regularly get, you know, around recital time, I usually get requests for it. I think it's one of the only pieces out there in the contemporary percussion literature that actually confronts or deals with hip hop. It's very unusual. Maybe in the contemporary music literature overall. They were interested in jazz, they were interested in rock, but for some reason they weren't interested in hip hop. It might have had something to do with what Steve was talking about, but in the end, I didn't see any reason why it had to be so personalized. At some point, you know, we as actors take on many roles. If you want to look at it in terms of the theater, I mean, you could say that having Steve, writing the piece for Steve was like, colorblind casting, you know? But in the end, I guess I wasn't looking at it in that way. I was looking at it as, well, this is a piece that is a hybrid. It combines a lot of elements of different kinds of classical music, hip hop. And so at a certain point, someone who could do the code switching, the way the piece is code switching, is something that we all have to do, I think. And something that we've all had to confront ourselves with. And I like the idea that this is something that's turning out to be important now. I mean, it touches on issues of white privilege. It touches on all kinds of things that at the time were not as well, not thought about by a large public the way they are today. And so for that reason, I think there's something still here about this piece that resonates with what people are experiencing now. So we'll talk about opera for a while. This is an opera I made in 2015 called Afterword. Once again, dealing with issues of voice, and this is probably my most extended project, finished in 2015. And I developed the libretto for Afterword from transcriptions of interviews from my 2008 book, which is just a shameless ad for the book, if you want to get that book. it's still in print. It's a big, fat academic book, about 700 pages, called A Power Stronger Than Itself. It's about the AACM, founded on the South Side of Chicago in 1965. I might have talked about this book on this stage a few years ago when Professor Banfield invited me to be here for a few days, a wonderful same kind of thing. I was right here. We were talking about this book. I don't think the opera had been done yet, so this is maybe the sequel in some ways. Founded on, maybe some of you know about the AACM, the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians, which was founded on the South Side of Chicago in 1965, an organization I was a member of starting from 1971 to the present. Long played an internationally recognized role in American experimental music. You know, over 50 years of work, AACM musicians developed new and influential ideas about sound and collectivity, extended technique, instrumentation, intermedia, computer music technologies, invented acoustic and electronic instruments, a lot more than that. So the AACM's unique combination of artistic communitarianism, personal and collective self-determination, and really ardent experimentalism, that's what inspires this project. So the original model for the opera's libretto was the concluding chapter from the book called the Afterword Chapter, which the book introduced with a discussion of James Clifford, the anthropologist's influential essay on ethnographic authority. And I use this essay I commend that to all of you. I use this essay as a touchstone for establishing my working method for the chapter and later for the opera. Clifford writes, "One increasingly common way to manifest the collective production of ethnographic knowledge is to quote regularly and at length from informants. But such quotations are always staged by the quoter and tend to serve merely as examples or confirming testimonies." You know, they say what you want them to say. "Looking beyond quotation, one might imagine a more radical polyphony, but this too would only displace ethnographic authority, still confirming the final virtuoso orchestration by a single author of all the discourse in his or her text." Now, beyond the obvious musical metaphor for this notion of ethnography, in the book, I had to admit my presence as an orchestrator. And the final chapter was, what I did with the final chapter was I took a lot of, I went through all the 100 interviews I made for the book, and I decided to, I found themes throughout all of them, you know, themes like, what is it? So what are these things? The individual, expansion, sacrifice, tradition, regrets, survival, the future, things of that sort. I mean, I didn't prompt the people to talk about these things. This is what they wanted to talk about. And a lot of these people talked about the same kinds of things. So I was able to collate these under certain key aspects of the chapter. It was kind of like a bit of experimental writing at the end of what was otherwise a pretty academic book. And I found that even though I was the so-called virtuoso orchestrator, my power in that respect was far from absolute. The voices really bring their own resonances. I would call it an unstable polyphony, if not a radical polyphony, certainly an unstable polyphony of quoted voices. And that would exceed my attempt as an author to fully control them. So the quotes were from people who, by the time I published the book, some of them were no longer alive. So it was like, you know, almost the idea of the living and the ancestors in conversation. So that was what I was trying to do. And imagine intergenerational discussion, which also included their comments on the book project itself. People wanted to, they really wanted the book to come out, you know, because they, first of all, they'd seen a lot of efforts by, they'd all tried to write a book. And they said, we should write a book. Well, nobody had time to write a book. You know, and I had a lot of support. I was an academic. I got a MacArthur grant. I had time and money to write a book. So it would be a waste of time not to do it with all those resources when other people, you know, weren't able to do it. So I was given these things, so it came to me to do it. So people were very concerned. They wanted to know about the book project. They had great hopes for it, you know. You know, who knows? Books are powerful still. It was an imagined intergenerational discussion and treating overarching issues that the organization and society more generally continue to face, asking how new relations among expression, culture, politics, race, gender, personal aspiration can be forged, given the class and race-mediated refrains and anxieties of American cultural life. I worked on this with two other lead artists, film theater artist Catherine Sullivan and composer-director Sean Griffin. And we saw this interpenetration of scholarly and artistic method as a vital touchstone for an operatic experience. So, Afterword also is not a history of the AACM. It's you know, I started making, I made up this term, I thought I'd made it up, the Bildungsoper, you know, like a Bildungsroman, a coming-of-age novel, German, you know. But it turned out I hadn't made it up, that Humboldt had made it up, but it was a long time ago. But people had forgotten that, so I, a while back, my German student, Harald Kasidu, told me that, you know, Humboldt started it, sorry. musicology. The libretto, okay, so I drew the libretto, as I said, for the interviews I conducted for the book, as well as audio recordings of, they recorded all their meetings. After about a year of working with Mulhall Richard Abrams on interviewing him and telling him stuff, I'm sitting there at his house, he says, well, you know, George, I might have some tapes of some of the early meetings. What? We've been talking for a year, you didn't... You're just now telling me about the tapes? So he pulls out this big box, right? And there are these tapes, a bunch of tapes in these white boxes, unlabeled, wow, as far as I could see. And he pulls out one. I said, I think this is the one we want to hear. It was. So what we hear on these tapes are basically young black experimentalists interrogating issues of power, authority, identity, culture, aesthetics, self-fashioning, representation. So I'm translating that into sung and spoken voices, instrumental music, and movement. And those are heteroglossic avatars. They become like what people say about the Toni Morrison novels, the expression of a community voice. Sometimes the community voice presents remembrances and testimony. In others, clashes between subject positions allow us to eavesdrop on history as it's being made in real human time. So we start to see these things: spiritual growth, race, gender, and sexuality, innovation, tradition, change, self-determination, self-government. And the challenge here was to create an opera around a collective that remains noted for its diversity of approaches to creative practice, while at the same time really avoiding direct character representation of AACM artists. Like, people would ask me, well, who's going to play Mulhall? And I said, well, it's not that kind of opera. You know, there's no this idea of the fixed authorial characters, historical figures, as Foucault would put it, historical figures at the crossroads for a certain number of events. Instead of that, I decided to have music, text, and movements display a kind of trickster-like displacement of character onto really metaphysical collectivities. Okay? So we get a kind of coming-of-age opera, Bildungsroman, about a group of African-American musicians who decide to revise both their view of themselves and to expand the frame of their possibilities beyond toward a kind of post-genre practice. So one example of this comes from recordings. I'll play for you now one of the recordings that Abrams made of the first organizational meetings held in Chicago on May 8th, 1965. Now, this is saxophonist Gene Easton, who was a signatory to the original charter, and this is the Transition East Band, which met every week in Chicago in 1975. And this sort of sleepy fellow here, holding a trombone, is me, and and you might, if you are familiar with this field, you might know some others. Romley, Michael Davis, Frank Gordon. Trombone player Steve Galloway, Billy Howell. Sabu Zawadi, Pete Cozy, Henry Threadgill, Chico Freeman, I forget who that was. Anyway, it might be Wes Cochran, I don't know. But I'm using this as the kind of backdrop for this monologue. See, the thing is, you gotta remember, they're having a meeting about how to change their lives. They're talking all together. They're not performing for anyone, like a lot of times oral history interviews have a performative aspect. They're just using very courtly language. All the meetings were conducted with using Robert's rules of order. You're out of order, you know, point of order, all this kind of stuff, you know, it's all there. And so they're trying to learn how to govern themselves. So this is what it kind of sounded like. I hope I can give you a sense of this. You can read it, the words are up there.
I think we're getting closer to this, to an explanation of this term, original music. Among some of us, it means something a little deeper than others. Original, in one sense, means something you write in the particular system that we are locked up with now in this society. We express ourselves in this system because it's what we learn. And as we learn more of other systems of music around the world, I mean, it's quite natural today, and we are getting closer to the music that our ancestors played and which we are denied the right to really stretch out in. And this term original, I feel that the authors of this business structure here had in mind more so sound conscious musicians, if necessary, finding a complete new system to express its us. Mm-hmm. If you don't express in that is known, you're ostracized.
So you see the belief in the power of music to change their lives. And to you have to find your own system. That's an old African American thing, right? Got to get your own voice. You have to like be yourself and all this. You see this constantly. If you read Arthur Taylor, the drummer's book of interviews, Notes and Tones, it's asserted over and over. Well, you know, Errol Garner says, well, you know, even if you really love somebody, you got to find out what's inside you and let that out, you know. So finding a complete new system that expresses us means that you're finding, if you can do that, you're well on the way to a kind of liberation. And you're also at the same time getting closer to the actual true tradition, which is not some stereotype notion of genre, but the idea of originality itself, what they meant by original music. And we're locked up with a particular system right now in the society. Now, these were people who mainly did club dates and were doing like, you know, sort of jazz jam sessions that maybe some of them, they knew how to do it. They'd all been growing up doing it, but they wanted to find something else to do. And so being, in other words, if you're locked up with a musical system, that's not the only system you're locked up with. You know, you're being in a way, you got to break out. So how do you do that? How do you do that? You do that through learning about what's happening around the world. You learn that by becoming, you break out by becoming a cosmopolitan. You exceed the strictures that are placed on you, the idea of what's expected of you, who the society says that you are. And so, and then later at the end, and you're going to see this in what I'm going to play here, because basically this was one of the scenes that I translated into the opera. There's expression on, we found that there are far better systems, and there's expression on a much higher level than we'd been led to believe, and we'll be locked up for the rest of our days in this system unless we can get out of it through some means as this. So this is our, it's a little bit, the aspect ratio is a little weird, but here we go.
Promoting all souls.
that's one scene. So yes, that basically that whole part was, you know, that's basically pretty much a dramatization of what happened in the meeting. You know, it's sometimes it's very funny. I showed this opera to some people who are in the ACM, and they'd say, "Well, I was able to say, well, that's you said that." I says, "I don't remember it." Well, it was 50 years ago. Now, this is the last section of this. This is the ACM musicians, several of them went to Paris in 1969, and that became a very important means of opening themselves up to the world. Once again, finding out that there are far better systems around the world. And so this is something that turned up at that time. So that last production was the avant-premiere, one of the avant-premieres in the Czech Republic at the Ostrava Days Festival in Ostrava in the Czech Republic. Directed by Sean. This is the premiere, which happened, the official premiere in October 2015, which was directed by both Catherine Sullivan and Sean Griffin. And this is the arrival in Paris scene in the second act. It was a two-act opera. Inside Baseball is about a piece I wrote in 2011, 4 years before this, called Anthem. The ensemble Wet Ink in New York, around 2009, they got in touch with me very graciously about creating a work for a series of pieces. They wanted to have a so-called specified ensemble, like a band, really. They were going to take around, and it'll be go on tour with relatively limited parts complement, particularly in percussion. So, and they include, of course, voice, the amazing vocalist and composer Kate Soper, then is now. And I hadn't really written for voice in a number of years, and I once again, I wanted to lean away from like setting the text in the way that people do, you know? I mean, you notice one thing I wanted to say about the way I do texts is that I try to, I'm interested in prosody. I'm not that interested in phonemic distortion, you know, like someone goes, you know, this. I'm starting to try to get into it, but the opera is really, it was as much for the members of the ACM so they could, you know, so they could hear their history. It was like making them all read Alex Haley or something, you know. So if I had a bunch of stuff that people couldn't really understand, you know, because I was doing composerly stuff with it, which I could easily do. That wasn't going to do what was needed. So I tend to, in my text writing, I tend to sort of have things that are understandable in that way. I mean, maybe it's a conservative viewpoint, maybe. So in any event, let me see if I can find this for you. I'm not really a creative writer, but I do have some experience with algorithmic processes. So some research I was doing on improvisation brought me to this 1947 book by a Catholic nun, Sister Miriam Joseph, called Shakespeare's Use of the Arts of Language. Now, Joseph's book really basically neatly analyzes and taxonomizes the vast number, about 250 or so, devices, rhetorical devices and forms that Elizabethan school children had to learn in Shakespeare's time. It had to learn to deploy these in extemporaneous debate. You see some of them, like syncope, syncopation, the removal of a letter or a syllable from the middle of a word as prosperous for prosperous, you know, or the exchange of one sound for another as rang for wrong, usually for the sake of rhyme, was called, I can't even pronounce his name, antistikon, you know. And so the connection with music seemed evident enough to a lot of people. One contemporaneous commentator wrote, learning the figures of classical rhetoric is like learning the scales of music. Well, sort of, not exactly. I mean, listen, he says, hath not music her figures the same which rhetoric? What is a revert but her antistrophe? Her reports but sweet anaphoras? Her counterchange of points, antimetaboles? Her passionate airs, prosopopoeias? And so on. So I got rhythm. AABA form becomes diacope, you know. My horse, my kingdom for a horse, or free at last, thank God Almighty, we're free at last. So I wasn't using specific rhetorical figures. Regarding the figures as algorithmic processes allowed me to compose the text, you know, and instrumental forms using sort of concatenative procedures. And so the text, of course, is about positioning its performers as the best band in the land, which is a sentiment I hardly endorse on the recording. And every band needs a band song, so I thought this would be useful for them in that regard. So let me show you a couple of the models for this. Before we hear the entire piece, I'll show you some of the models. This is one of the models.
Oh, Superman. Oh, John.
So this is, in a way, my translation of that. So we'll go past that, and here's... So this is a variation, these kind of concatenative variations, which are suggested by the Sister Miriam Joseph text. Another thing is that is the Ulippian, Ulippo, meaning ouvroir de littérature potentielle, O-U-I-L-I-P-O, which is a sort of a literary and actually musical movement of the 60s in France, who are interested in doing sort of algorithmic concatenative procedures for creating texts or doing things like writing novels in which the letter E was missing for the entire novel, like Georges Perec or something like that. And this is something, I was in a conference called Play as Inquiry with Ken Wark, and he distributed this, a group of things, Arthur Rimbaud, Roussel, Perec, Breton, people like this, all these kinds of examples of ways to play with language. And one of the ones I've always liked has been this one, Raymond Queneau's 100 milliards de poèmes, which is basically an algorithmic poem book based in, I'd say, loosely on Noam Chomsky's sort of syntactic structures idea. And so I'll just play this. It's in French, but you'll get it anyway.
Autre exemple, alors je crois l'un des plus beaux, c'est les 100 000 milliards de poèmes de Raymond Queneau,
oui.
Que j'aimerais qu'on puisse voir vraiment d'une manière matérielle, qui se feuillette,
oui.
C'est cela. Ces 100 000 milliards de poèmes, ce sont 10 sonnets écrits par Raymond Queneau, dans lesquels, 10 sonnets qui sont superposés, mais dans lesquels chaque premier vers peut être remplacé par n'importe quel autre premier vers.
En déplaçant ces feuilles que l'on voit actuellement sur l'écran.
En déplaçant. De telle manière que vous pouvez faire 10 puissance 14, 14 c'est le nombre de vers d'un sonnet, ça n'est pas le cadavre exquis comme vous allez sur réaliste. Dans ce sens que, quel que soit les sonnets que vous faites, vous avez la garantie d'abord de toujours trouver la rime, et surtout, l'enchaînement grammatical est garanti.
So you can make your own poem by just substituting, by turning a little bit of the page, and creating a totally different poem on there. So, 100 milliards de poèmes, that's 100 million billion poems, that's a lot of poems, based on one little book. So the other sources are, there are two sources here. There's Kate Soper, and we all know the other guy. And So that was, of course, James Brown, the Mother Popcorn, which is, I think, the Live in Augusta, Georgia record, which has always been one of my favorites. And so where that turns up is something like this. So you get a sense of where that goes. And also there's another source. Kurt Schwitters, the Ur Sonata from 1932.
Kurt Schwitters spricht Teile seiner Sonate mit Urlauten. Der Bebe, der Bebe, Fünfe, der Bebe, Fünfe, Bebe, Fünfe, Bebe, Fünfe, Bebe, Zeu,
Begibbe,
Wie, der Sünder, Iem, Pütto, Tö, You ka rinsa kada bebe hinskermu, tsiu hinsa tsiu rinskermu, rakata bebe, rum tu tu, tsiu hinsa tsiu hinsk.
And so on. So, sort of a Dada, one of the most famous sort of early sound poetry works done by all kinds of people. But it occurred to me that there was some political relationship here. And Anthem, in a way, brings together James Brown and James Joyce, Kurt Schwitters, Laurie Anderson, and a lot of other people. And so this is Stephen Schick, go back to him, performing the Ur Sonata.
Firms rubitate say opera give qui a. They listen e a buff to you. Rinsker baby inskern you. See what it's you. Rinskern you. Racket the baby. Seek the baby.
Okay. So it occurred to me that, because when I saw this on at the Armory in New York City, it was on these giant screens, much bigger than this. And it looked like Big Brother was talking to me and saying completely nonsense, you know? But it didn't make any difference because it gave the opinion of someone who was very, it gave the impression of like someone of great power. And so maybe this is a message I didn't understand that I should try to understand. Or maybe this is just something, you know, I needed to listen to it. I needed to like even obey it, you know? And so that brought me to this.
Hopefully we can rise above partisan politics in order to support national security. Some have suggested a barrier is immoral.
You didn't see this, right? Some guy got, someone working on Fox News, a local Fox News station, decided they, you know, to do this, this sort of took the, and to broadcast this in real time and create their own kind of version of Donald Trump kind of spazzing out along the lines of this, more or less. The thing is that, you know, Donald Trump makes so little sense when he's up there talking, the State of the Union address, he might as well be reading the Ur Sonata. Yeah. Look, you could just take the text of the Ur Sonata, take the tape of the State of the Union address and superimpose the Ur Sonata on it. I bet 90% of the time they match up. You might as well be doing that. And so at some point it shows it doesn't matter what the content is, it's the package in which the content comes. And this sort of monumentality, an anthem as a work is about desire, monumentality, and I'm going to play it for you.
Thank you. me. We gotta be your band. Listen to me. Listen to me. We gotta be your band. Baby, please. We gotta be your band. We know you know. You know we know. We know, you know we know.
Thank you. There's a lot of quotes in these things, and there's one of them is from the Four and More record of Miles Davis, the Tony Williams solo, where he goes, And then George Coleman comes in with a solo, so it's really fast. So that's it. There it is. That's it. So, yeah, so, you know, when the drummer was talking about it, I said, well, that's where it comes from. That's where the lick comes from. So that's one of those licks that starts off the whole part of Anthem, comes from there. I always like that little thing where he comes up with this amazing thing. It's an amazing solo. Anyway, yes, please. Questions? Yes, comments, whatever.
It's interesting for students. They think that, you know, people are creative and they just go into a room somewhere and they have ideas, or they just go with their band and experiment. But you seem to have so much knowledge and connection to all kinds of music of the past, you know, a real, to be able to draw all kinds of reference. And can you talk a little bit about the importance of really knowing the repertoire and different kinds of music? It's not just what you do, but your community or whatever.
I don't know. I think music comes from communities, you know. Like you said, the idea of going into a little room by yourself and doing stuff. I mean, people never really did that, but there was a myth that, you know, sort of Beethoven myth, you know, or whoever the person was, they went into a little artist garret and there's privation, you know, bad breath, all these things, you know, and at the end of the day, they came out with this masterpiece. And so, and that totally ignored the, you know, fact where Beethoven was living. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff going on. You could go out and talk to people all the time. You know, even before he was deaf, he was in touch with all these people. So the equivalent of that today is remember that, what was that commercial, What's on Your iPod? You know, I mean, there's many more different kinds of things on iPods of anybody in this room than there is on mine. And so that comes down to, but if you don't look at it as just, well, I'm consuming this right away, but then you tend to get into it, as people here would do, they're musicians, right? People get into the traditions, they find out more about it. You know, you accumulate, you try to remember. I think that's part of the academic project is remembrance. You don't want to forget stuff. You have to have a good memory. And then you have to be curious. And in my case, I feel like I fell in with a lot of good crowds. And so they got accepted by a lot of people to greater or lesser extent, and they helped me. And so I sort of tried to remember what they had to say after I realized that it wasn't about what I had to say, it was about what they had to say. And so I learned to be quiet after a while and listen to them. It was very helpful. And so it's still a skill that's in great demand, and you know, being a professor now, you do a lot of talking to people, but I think at some point, during the nature of my work as a professor, I have to listen a lot, so that ends up helping me quite a bit. So, so I think that would be the most compact answer to that, which is sort of like being aware of the need to listen and the need to engage and to not really approach everything with a kind of beginner's mind and just try to be more accepting of experience, you know. I notice a lot of writers I know, they really pride themselves on the range of experiences they have, you know. And they go into artist garrets too, you know, but then you always hear about them, you know, drinking with everybody, you know. I mean, a lot of musical scenes, a lot of artistic scenes, a good bar is very important. They all go to the same bar, you know. So, but that's where a lot of things get exchanged. And so communities, and what you hear in my music are a lot of the communities I've been in touch with. So the music comes from those communities. And I think of them as being a lot more integrated in my mind than maybe even they are in real life. So in a way, I get to produce a community, a virtual community, which, what if I was able to invite all these people to the same party and they all knew as much about each other as I knew about them? You know, could be. Maybe that's one way of looking at it. Yeah, please.
I don't really want to allow the students to talk, but we have some questions. So I'd like to yield the floor to students before I ask my question.
I don't know which ones of you are students, so just go ahead and start talking. Who's only raised their hand behind you? Two people over here. Those first people I saw. Kira, you were first?
Yeah. In this interview in the past, you talked about technical
I do? Okay. I'll try to remember what I said. Well, I find I'm a member of a number of communities, and so that could be a problem within each of the communities, is that they engage in that to some extent. So, but there are always people in each of these communities that are open to things beyond that. I'm posing that as a kind of danger which people have to fight against, which you have to be constantly on guard, to be a kind of vigilant against that possibility, because it's made possible by the internet, obviously, even more. I might have said that before they even had the internet, but now with that, you know, people don't have to listen to whatever voices they don't find convenient. But in music, it seems to me there's not much of a penalty for listening to weird music you never heard of before. I mean, they used to have something called, it probably had different names in different cities, but the Midnight Special on the radio, right? And that would be some weirdo, like one person who ran the Midnight Special in New Haven was Jerry Hemingway, the drummer. He had this radio show where anything could go on, you know? So he was the one who ran the Midnight Special when I was there. But other people are running it too. And so we sort of don't have that now for a number of reasons. But in a way, the World Wide Web is the Midnight Special, but it runs 24 hours a day. So that you could, in fact, avoid that if you really wanted to. I just find there's so much out there. Like, you know, I teach classes in music. You know, I just go on YouTube. It's all sort of sitting there. It could be just about any amazing things that are on the air now. Including, I'll show you a bit of this if you want, but more questions, please, while I pull this up. Yes, the person in front of you, Kira, wanted to chat, I think. Let me say something. You wanted to talk, didn't you?
All
right.
I have a question about the
Gerst
magic. Thank you. First of all, thanks for coming.
Oh, thanks very much. Yeah, it's great.
Your process and your
sorry about that. It's going to come in pretty soon. Yeah, well, you know, I'm not much of a believer in purity. And we're always searching for the unmediated pure space. I don't think we get it. You know, there's just too many layers sitting there. It's like the search for essences, you know, like, you know, if you found an essence, you'd be really shocked. But I think that when I think about even something like this, let me give you an example. There's a pure sound right here on this video, which is from 1991 with Leon Theremin and a bunch of us. And there's the guy who brought us there, this Komarov, who's, I just put this up. I've had this video since 91. I made this video. So then we're all there. And so here's Paul Lansky getting a theremin lesson. Okay, now let's see. Let's see who else is in there. Oh, here's John Chowning. He's getting one. And then I'm going to get one. It's going to be kind of fun. But let me give you an example. Before I play mine, I'm going to play you Natasha's. This is his daughter. Okay, so what do I hear in that? The first thing I hear, wasn't looking at it really. What I hear, just based on what I hear, is that there's not much in timbre there. It's like basically like a, some sort of indeterminate wave, maybe it's a triangle wave, and she's sort of articulating that, and she's trying to play notes with it. But it's sort of the bare bones. It's like the barest bones musical sound you can imagine. Just, ooh, you know, there's nothing happening. But she's making all this music out of it, and she seems very confident about it. But she also has to like compensate because Paul is kind of sight reading his part, and sometimes it's not. It's a little slow, so he's working on it, and so on. So that's the confident version. It's interesting that the sound itself is carrying these messages of security, insecurity, communication. So it's not pure at all. And so this, and so I'll give you, if you want more evidence of that, here's my version of it. It was so impure.
Everybody's body's there. Not good.
I was so bad at it that the maestro came to show me how it was done. Really strong grip for a 95-year-old man. So there was a change right there in the confidence level. Now, I'm going to say that I wasn't quite as clueless about the theremin as I made out. But, you know, I wanted to kind of, you know, in a sense, that was the right response. And so if just for a last little bit of it, the thing that I found exciting about the theremin was that it was a kind of emotional transduction. In other words, who played it? This very simple, super simple dispositif was nonetheless able to bring out aspects of who you were inside. So there's another problem with the purity motif is that the purity part excludes human experience. And so so purity is a very dangerous narrative. So then here's after she finishes, he does it himself.
And by moving my hand, I change this field. And so if I have a hand, for instance, or big one, it's a big influence. If it's small, it's as great as possible to play, we change in the height, in the pitch, or by movement or hand, or just by movement, this part, yes. Or the movement of the fingers, such a way as it will make.
You can hear that's just a test, right? That's my roundabout way of answering your question. To talk about communities, by the way, just off as an aside, there's a whole section. Those of you, this is on YouTube. You can see it. There's a whole section on this tape, I believe, about Lavinia Williams. I don't know if people know who she is, the African American dancer and choreographer who was a student of Catherine Dunham, they were married. Theremin and Lavinia Williams were married, and I didn't know that. When we were here in '91, I didn't really know who Lavinia Williams was. So suddenly he mentioned her out of the blue, and asked if we had heard about her, and none of us had. And it turned out she had died in 75, so she never knew what happened to him, and he never knew what happened to her, because it was kind of apparently a kidnapping situation. So he was taken out of the country by the Soviets to work on various things. But then I found a little bit more about how they met. See, the thing is, a lot of it is when you have to try to get around a little bit outside your zone, right? So there I was in the Rutgers Jazz Archives, and they said, we have two great collections, the Mary Lou Williams collection, the James P. Johnson collection. So I went to both, and I looked around, and I was looking around the James P. Johnson collection. It was so poignant, you know? I mean, James P. Johnson was trying to get his orchestral music performed. At first, he was working with William Grant Steele on orchestration. Then he learned how to orchestrate. So the stuff sounded great. He could never get a gig. He could never get a Guggenheim or any kind of grant. He could never get his stuff done. So I think probably he had all this money from the Charleston, which is very famous, you know. And so he was using that to fund his own performances of multimedia stuff, right? Dance, music, sound, all this kind of stuff, and his chamber music. So there was a program there. And in the program, it said James P. Johnson music, Lavinia Williams dance, Leon Theremin sound. I said, wow. I said, who'd have thunk it? So there you go. Any other questions? Yes, please.
I was wondering, do you often get a chance to work with the groups that perform your music? And
if yes. Well, they mainly rehearse and instruct me. I mean, like, look, if this kind of music, you know, if you have something to say, you put it in the score, you know, and its score is pretty exacting. Like, for example, let me go back to this thing here. So here we are. This is not such a great thing, but if you thought that drum solo was improvised, it wasn't. That's the first thing. Then, let me see if I can zero in. Probably can't, you know, a couple of these things here. You see, let me see if I can zero in on the vocal part. It sounds superficially like Sprechstimme, right? Which is kind of indeterminate. But this is not indeterminate. She's singing the exact pitches that are here. So if she sings the pitches that are here, she'll get this kind of vocal inflection, right? And that's, you know, so it's not so much that I have to show her how to do it. It's like, she just does it. At first, I think she might have even thought it was going to be like Sprechstimme, right? I said, no, you got to sing the actual notes. And when she started singing that, she was like, I know you love us. I know you. I know you. Now I see how much you want to. You know, it's basically there. So it's not so much a question with this kind of music. Now, there are other pieces which involve improvisation, it does help. But increasingly, I'm trying to make pieces where they don't need me to be there. They can construct. If it's a piece that involves improvisation, then the toolkit should be able to give them enough information to realize not what I want, but what they want. Okay. Now, if it's something like this, then if the notation is sufficiently, it doesn't have to be super detailed, because sometimes that's a barrier to understanding. But if it's detailed enough so that people know what they can do, then I find most of the time when I come in, it's like I'm just saying, wow, it's great. I don't have to teach people a lot of stuff, you know. And oftentimes, they're teaching me a lot of, they're generally much conductors, they're much better at music making than I am. I mean, Professor Carrick has recast my piano parts into the semblance of intelligibility. So, you know, so he's actually teaching me. I'm not teaching him. except I'm showing him how a non-piano player writes piano music. Are there other questions? I think Professor Banfield wanted to ask a question. Yeah, we're putting you in.
Through lies, George, I mean, some of our college students brought up that you are making mentions from
Well, some of them are still around. The ACM, because I mean, there are people in their 20s in the ACM.
Yeah, no, but my point is,
the olders,
you
yeah.
were playing with them.
Well, that's true.
Right, back then. So now you're teaching now. What is the through line in terms of the kind of cultural relevance and musical experience that you're finding your students, that they're able to follow you through these various periods? Is there a through line? Because that's what we're all dealing with when we make these references. How do we get students to see the relevance of all these connections? What have you found as a through line that connects decades?
God, you know, that's, you know, I'm, it's, I think that's very, it's a kind of a humanistic question.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, we're human beings who believe that, or at least I believe, that this music we're making, I'm hoping that people listen to a piece like this, and that they come out of the concert hall thinking, wow, that was really different. And then their next question is, I wonder what else could be different around here. So that, and then that leads to the possibility of subversion, the possibility that things could be different than they are. And I think that's what allies us, is that once we experience all these different communities, these different kinds of music, the main through line is that things could be different than they are, and it's our job to realize that and to show the possibility that we don't have to accept what's presented to us, that we can create for ourselves. And that's the AACM situation. That's what all each of you has to do, regardless of what particular genre you're in or you feel you're in or whatever. And but that's part of a human condition of change. Whereas Muha used to say, change is synonymous with any conception of the deity. So I don't know. That's as far as I could take that on short notice. Hope that helps. Well, I suppose I've overstayed my time, so it's time to go. Thank you.